So this. So we will start the cardiovascular and the renal pharmacology, another important topic, because recently we have completed the endocrine and reproductive pharmacology is concerned. So the cardiac physiology, we have to learn initially with the cardiac physiology, especially how the heart functions normally, then what are all the waves, the electrophysiology, then the drugs, especially acting on the cardiovascular tissues are concerned. So coming to the first introduction, the cardiovascular system, it functions as an autonomic organ, and it circulates the blood, oxygen and nutrients in the body. So you know it very, very well. And the functional components of the cardiovascular systems are, three components are there. Number one is heart. The second one is the blood vessels, which are distributed throughout the body. And third one is the blood. And closed system, especially closed system, and blood never leaves the blood vessels and heart. Totally, it's a closed system because it is not having any openings wherever it is required. So the heart, the blood vessels and the blood, these three components make the cardiovascular system as a syncytial unit of function. Then the functional anatomy of the heart is, it is containing three components. There are three types of the cardiac muscles. The number one is atrial muscle, number two is the ventricular muscle, and the specialized or excitatory, and the conducive conductive muscles. So three varieties of the muscles are there in the cardiovascular system. So once again, there are two types of classifications are there among these muscles: excitatory muscles and the conductive muscles. So excitatory muscles are the one like the sinoatrial node and atrioventricular node. So these are having the excitatory action, whereas the conductive muscles through which the electrical current passes. That's the A is bundle of His, and the Purkinje fibers are the conductive muscles, of course. So the cardiovascular action potential, so the cardiac action potential is a little bit different from that of the neural vascular potential. Then the action potential for electric conduct system of the heart, there are two types of the electrophysiology, then autonomic fiber and non-autonomic fiber. So this is a very simple way of understanding the cardiac action potential. The autonomic fibers are there, and also the non-autonomic fibers are there. And we will see what are all these non-autonomic fibers. So the autonomic fibers, everyone knows about these particular things are there. Then the non-autonomic fibers do not have the property of spontaneous depolarization, whereas the autonomic fibers do have the spontaneous depolarization capacity and shows fast channel action potential. Here both sodium, which is having the fast sodium current, and calcium, it is a slow channel, cause the action potential. And non-autonomic fibers include the atrial fibers, ventricular fibers and the Purkinje fibers. So all these function in a different or discrete manner. So here the action potential in non-autonomic fibers is like this. So it is divided into these five phases to understand the better. In the you might have learned the all these things in the cardiac physiology. So the first one is the phase zero. So here rapid depolarization takes place. So then the phase one, this is the phase 1, immediately the depolarization takes place and the phase 1 is initial repolarization starts here. The phase 2 is plative phase, this phase 2 is a plative phase, and the phase 3 is the late repolarization. Repolarization starts here. Phase 4 is resting membrane potential because it is coming to the base level. So this is functioning like this, and the ventricular muscle action potential is different type. Resting membrane potential is minus 80 to minus 90 millivolts usually, and sodium and calcium channels are totally closed at the rest, means so the potassium channel open at rest. Rest means it's not a permanent rest, or else the person will get a permanent rest. So the potential channels are the one which are opened at the time of the resting period, which is when pulses arrive. The one phase 0, what happens is sodium channel open and there is a rapid influx of the sodium and rapid depolarization, very similar to that of the other action potentials are concerned. Then phase 1, the sodium channels inactivated, then the phase membrane repolarized via opening the potassium channels. Just a minute. Yes. So the cardiac pharmacology is the one CVS public. Okay. So here then just where is my presentation? Yes. So the phase 1, especially the phase 1, is the sodium channels are inactivated, membrane repolarized via opening up of the potassium channels, whereas the phase 2 is opening up of the slow calcium channels, then prolonged plative of the depolarization starts. Then the phase 3, calcium channels close after 200 milliseconds. So the time plateau is the potassium channels start opening. Then the phase 4, stable negative resting membrane potential. So here phase 0 to phase 4, all these activities will happen. Whereas the atrial muscle action potential is having the slow calcium channels open for shorter time and the potassium channels close for also the shorter time. And shorter and less plative of the action potential will be there, and the shorter action potential, short refractory period, these are all the characteristic of the atrial muscle potential. Then more action potential or per minutes are also the characteristic, whereas here you can see that the minus CLT volt is the resting membrane potential, especially in the heart, and this is phase is called as the phase 0. Here the sodium channel opens and at the same time it goes to the peak, whereas in the phase 1 the slow calcium channels open, and whereas in case of phase 2 the inactivation of the sodium channel takes place here, whereas the In the phase 3, the potassium channel starts action. So calcium channel close and potassium channels open and repolarization occur. And in case of this phase 4, then it is totally under rest. So this duration, one cardiac beat is 200 milliseconds. And automatic fibers are the one present in the sinoatrial node and AV node, and patches present in AV ring, His Purkinje system especially. And the sinoatrial node possesses intrinsic rhythmicity, autorhythmicity, automaticity, pacemaker activity. So the resting membrane potential in these automatic fibers, especially the sinoatrial nodes, where the automatic action potential is generated for the cardiac beat. So in the sinoatrial node, resting membrane potential is the minus 55 to minus 60 millivolt when compared to the other muscle fibers, atrial muscle fiber. So the lac voltage gated fast sodium channels before lac phase 0, they also phase 0, and possesses pacemaker sodium channel. So what happens is the opening up of the pacemaker sodium channel at resting membrane potential, and there will be progressive influx of sodium depolarization of the cells towards the threshold, and then the potassium channel open at the end of the action potential begins to close, very similar to that of the other action potential. And some calcium channels open, calcium especially the entry into the cell occurs and speeds the spontaneous depolarization, then there is threshold is achieved. Whereas the threshold reached at minus 45 millivolts, and then slow calcium channel activated and it will open, and there will be rapid influx of calcium, action potential is ensues. So the initiation of the action potential, once again we will see the consequences: opening up of the pacemaker sodium channels at resting membrane potential, the progressive influx of sodium depolarization of cell towards the threshold level it is good, and potassium channel open at the end of the action potential begins to close. Then some slow calcium channels they open, then entry into the cell is going to happen. Then speeds spontaneous depolarization, the threshold will be achieved, and the threshold reaches as minus 45, and it is near to the positive, and the slow calcium channels activated and they open, and the rapid influx of the calcium ion action potential ensues. So initiation of the action potential occurs at higher threshold, and it is automatic, and it is called as the slow action potential, and it lacks rapid depolarization and has rounded appearance and caused by the slow calcium channels. Whereas in case of atrioventricular node, it is very similar to that of the SA node, but exhibit pacemaker activity and slow action potential, whereas the spontaneous depolarization is much slower than the SA node. Whereas the AV node receives the impulse from SA node when the cells are depolarization, that means one after the other they are going to take place. So the excitability is the one strength of the stimulus required to elicit a response to produce an action potential, and hyperpolarization decreases and excitability. So it is determined by the level of membrane potential at which the cardiac cells can generate the action potential. So the reduction in resting membrane potential increases the excitability of the action potential or the heart, and the cardiac conductivity includes the SA node, AV bundle, Purkinje fibers, and the bundle branches constitute the specialized conduction systems. So the impulse originates from SA node and spreads rapidly across right and left atria, causing both atria to contract simultaneously. Then impulse is carried from SA node to AV node and from AV node to bundle of His, which is divided into right and left bundle branches and which contract with the Purkinje fibers. And these fibers make contact with fibers of ventricle and become continuous with the total cardiac fibers. And the cardiac cycle, what's a cardiac cycle? So the conduction events that occur from beginning of one heartbeat to the next heartbeat. This is called as the cardiac cycle. So it consists of a period of relaxation called as the diastole, during which the heart fills with blood. Diastole is the phase in through which the heart is filled with blood. So that the a period of contraction is called as the systole. So if we take the diastole is first action of the heart, then after diastole a period of contraction occurs immediately, then that is called as the systole. And in a normal beat, both atria contract simultaneously followed by a pause. So both atrium are going to contract simultaneously to cause a pause. Then two ventricles contract simultaneously. So the delay of about 0.1 second between the passage of impulses from the one to atria to ventricle, it takes place. Then the atria contract ahead of the ventricles, thereby pumping blood into the ventricles. So after ventricular contraction, heart relaxes and refills and remains in resting state until the next beat starts. So this is the electrocardiogramic pattern, especially the recording of electrical activity generated by heart on a electrocardiogram. That's the change of electrical conductivity in the heart in the different stages of the heartbeat. So here you can see that this is the PR interval and this is called as the P wave. This, if you take a typical electrocardiogram, then this is the line showed with the yellow is called as the P wave. Then the line called as with this thing is the Q wave, and the R wave is with dark red, and this S wave is with this color. Then this one is the T wave, QRST, and both of these are resting phases. So here you can see that this is the in the beginning up of the P wave and the beginning up of the Q wave or end of the Q wave called as the PR interval, and the QRS complex is the one which contains the beginning up of the Q wave and ending up of the S complex. So that's called as the QRS complex. So the T wave is after this is end of this cardiac cycle, and this will be like that, whereas this segment beginning up of the T wave and end of the S wave is called as the S and T segment, ST segment. So P wave is called as atrial depolarization, means at this time the atria starts contraction. QRS complex, ventricular depolarization. So the P wave is atrial depolarization, QRS complex ventricular depolarization, then T wave is ventricular repolarization, means the beat is over and it is repolarizing. P PR interval time taken for impulse to travel from SA node to the ventricular muscle. And the QRS complex starts with the arrival of the impulse at AV node, then ends with activation of the Purkinje fibers. So this Q and T interval, Q to T interval, it is the ventricular systole or the ventricular contraction. So this always this wave will be, this similar pattern will continue for ever and ever till it stops the beating. So the P wave is atrial depolarization. Here if you take the P wave is atrial depolarization, then the QRS complex, it is ventricular depolarization here, then the QRS complex is ventricular depolarization, T wave is ventricular repolarization. The T wave is the ventricular repolarization. Then the PR interval is the time taken for impulse to travel from SA node to ventricular muscle. PR interval. And the QRS complex starts with the arrival of the impulse at AV node and ends with the activation of the His Purkinje fibers. Whereas the QT interval, the ventricular systole. So, and apart from this one, P wave and QRS complex, it is the, they are called as the depolarization wave, and the T wave is the repolarization wave. The atrial repolarization wave is masked by the QRS complex. So under this QRS complex, it is masked, and the abnormalities of the ECG, electrocardiogram, always the doctors take the electrocardiogram as the first line of diagnosis of a cardiac disorder. So the prolonged P and R interval, abnormality of conduction system, there is a problem. Whereas the short QT interval, increase in the heart rate. Then the excitation, contraction, then it is coupled. Mechanism by which the action potential causes myofibrils of the muscles. In the cardiac muscles, method is calcium induced and the calcium release. So it involves the conduction of calcium into cells, that's triggering further release of the ions into cytoplasm. Then the action potential is first induced by the pacemaker cells and conducted from the non-contractile to the contractile systems. So the triggers L-shaped channels during the plate tube of the action potential. So this is the system actually. This is the sarcolemma and the here all the adenosine triphosphate energy dependent mechanism, and also the here the action potential. So initially there will be opening up of the sodium channels, then the calcium channels, low calcium channels will be open, then after this the particular this thing, then the slow this potassium channel start opening here, and ultimately it is in the resting phase. Then calcium enters cardiac cell through voltage sensitive calcium channels. So the inward moving calcium triggers large release of the calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Here this is the sarcolemma and sarcoplasmic reticulum. So the spread of the action potential along with the T tubule also release the calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, especially of the cardiac muscles. Whereas the calcium also enters the cell through calcium and sodium exchanger pump. Whereas the enhanced intracellular calcium causes muscle contraction. So the calcium is the one, especially it's one of the main ion that is very helpful for the smooth muscle conduction, especially in the cardiac muscles. And the free systolic calcium after the contraction pumped back into the SR and the sarcoplasmic reticulum and mitochondria by the calcium ATPase. That's the mechanism. Whereas the free cytosolic calcium pumped out through the sodium and calcium exchanger mechanism is there, then the influx of the sodium through the voltage sensitive channel, and ultimately there is extrusion of sodium and intrusion of potassium through the sodium potassium ATPase. Then the regulation of the cardiac pump or pumping of the cardiac pumping results in volume of blood pumped per minute is total cardiac output. So the volume of the blood pumped per minute is called as the cardiac output, and heart rate is number of heartbeats per 1 minute or 60 seconds. Whereas the stroke volume is blood volume in ml pumped out of the heart with each beat of the heart, or stroke volume is the total blood volume in ml pumped out of the heart with every beat, whereas the cardiac output is equal to the stroke volume and heart rate totally. So the amount of the blood pumped regularly by two mechanisms, one is intrinsic regulation and another one is the autonomic nervous system. Then the intrinsic regulations means under physiological conditions, heart adjusts pumping activity by changing its total length. Then the when extra amount of blood flows into the heart, cardiac muscle is stretched. So the stretched cardiac muscle respond with enhanced contractile strength and pumping excess blood. So this intrinsic ability, this is the intrinsic ability to adapt the changing volume of inflowing blood is called as the Frank-Starling mechanism. So what is a Frank-Starling mechanism is, so under physiological conditions, heart adjusts pumping activity by changing its length, total length. So when extra amount of the blood flows into the heart, cardiac muscle is stretched to the greater extent. Then the stretched cardiac muscle respond with the enhanced cardiac strength pumping excess blood. Then this intrinsic activity means the self-adjustment capacity of the heart to adapt the changing volumes of inflowing blood is called as the Frank-Starling mechanism. Then the autonomic system, nervous system, also regulates the pumping by adjusting myocardial contractibility or rate of the contractibility or both many times. And the sympathetic stimulation increases both rate and force of the contraction. Means force of the rate means this inotropy, means inotropic effect means total cardiac rate. Chronotropic action means the force of the contraction is called as chronotropic. And the cardiac output can increase more than 100% by sympathetic stimulation, especially if you administer adrenaline or the isoproterenol, which are the sympathomimetics in nature. They cause the increased cardiac output more than 100%. And the parasympathetic system, it decreases the cardiac output, especially the vagal stimulation. Vagus nerve is a parasympathetic nerve which releases acetylcholine. Then the bradycardia with fewer heart rates per minute can also happen. That's about the very short, what you call as the introduction, and later we will go with the different drugs, especially which are acting on the heart, especially the cardiac glycosides are the one which are important drugs. So coming to the first one, that's the cardiac glycosides. So what are all these? Coming to the introduction, these are the group of the compounds having cardiac inotropic properties and also called as the digitalis or digitalis glycosides, and used in clinical management of CHF or the congestive heart failure. And these drugs are there to control cardiac arrhythmias. And these are commonly used glycosides include two drugs very importantly. That's the number one is the digitoxin and another one is the digoxin. And coming to the source and chemistry, they are present in number of plants and also the toad venom and prepared semi-synthetically nowadays in the market. And the digitalis is obtained from the dried leaf of the plant Digitalis purpurea, and all compounds are chemically, they are the glycosides. So the chemical compounds are, varieties of the chemical compounds are there. That's the, among these things, these are all the glycosides, especially acting on heart. And it contains a glycan moiety. It is a cyclopentanoparahydrophenanthrene nucleus, which is a 5 to 6 number lactone, which is attached to the C17 position. And the pharmacological activity, especially in case of the cardiac glycosides, is due to the A-glycan moiety, which is attached to the base molecule. And here, the source and chemical composition of some of the cardiac glycosides. So the compound is the digitoxin. It is obtained from the leaf of the plant Digitalis purpurea. So the A-glycan moiety of this digitoxin is digitoxygenin, is the A-glycan moiety, and this is biologically active. Another plant, Digitalis lanata. So from this also the digitoxin is obtained, and the digoxin is another compound which is also from the Digitalis lanata leaf, and it contains digoxygenin, whereas the digitoxin is obtained from the Digitalis purpurea leaf, and it is having the A-glycan moiety as digitoxygenin, whereas the xylitin is obtained from the many parts of the Digitalis purpurea, and the A-glycan moiety in this particular compound is the digitalygenin, whereas the gelatoxin, same plant Digitalis purpurea, and it is the gitaloxygenin. And aubaine, or it is also called as the strepanthin. So this is obtained from the a little different plant that is called as the Strepanthus gratus. So the A-glycan moiety is aubaine. So, or this is also called as the strepanthidine, and it is active against the heart. And apart from this one, strepanthin K, and it is obtained from the Strepanthus combe, and it contains the A-glycan moiety as strepanthidine. Whereas the another compound called as the lanatocyte C, it is also obtained from the Digitalis lanata, and it is the compound which is A-glycan moiety is digoxygenin. And the bufotoxin is obtained from the toads, it is also the Buffo vulgaris. And the semi-synthetic compounds are the acetyl digoxin, acetyl strepanthidine, and diacetyl lanatocide. So these compounds, three compounds, are semi-synthetically prepared. Whereas the buffo vulgaris or the buffo toxin is used just for the experimental purpose, just to induce the cardiac arrhythmias and many more actions. So this plant is called as the Digitalis purpurea, and this one with the white flower is called as the Digitalis lanata. And this plant is Strophanthus gratus with white and red flower both. So you might have seen this particular plant. And mechanism of action of these glycosides, cardiac glycosides, they bind selectively to membrane associated sodium potassium ATPase. Please remember that they are going to have the interaction with sodium potassium ATPase and binds to potassium binding site and reversibly inhibit the potassium pump. So what happens is this sodium potassium ATPase pump is going to be blocked, and progressive accumulation of sodium intracellular, which is favoring the exchange of sodium for calcium and through the sodium calcium exchanger mechanism. So the increased intracellular sodium slows extrusion of calcium, leading to increased release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, causing the increased force of contraction, that is the chronotropic effect, that is also called as the cardiac contractility. So please remember the mechanism action. It binds with the, especially the sodium potassium ATPase, then binds to the potassium binding site and reversibly inhibits the pump. So then progressive accumulation of sodium intracellularly, it is favoring the sodium for the calcium through the sodium calcium exchanger mechanism, and increased intracellular sodium slows the outward movement of the calcium, leading to increased release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and this causes the cardiac contractility. So the force of the contraction will be increased. Here you can see that whenever there is this is normal mechanism, calcium is coming in and sodium is coming in. Calcium is a sodium, this slow channel, whereas the sodium calcium exchanger mechanism is always working, and the later it happens in the earlier stage of the action potential. Then during the depolarization with the help of sodium potassium ATPase, the potassium will come inside and the digitalis is going to block this sodium potassium ATPase. So ultimately what happens, the depolarization phase will be blocked, and because of this thing the force of the contractility will be increased. So here the inhibition of the sodium potassium ATPase enzyme leads to the exchange of sodium potassium ion, stops this process, stops momentarily, and because of this thing there is more and more accumulation of the sodium ions inside, because the sodium potassium pump is stopped, and this occurs whenever there is increased intracellular sodium. Then this initiates a calcium sodium exchange mechanism inside the cell, then calcium go inside, it further triggers the release of calcium from the sarcoplasmic reticulum and also the mitochondria, and because of this action there will be more calcium inside the cell, and this increases the cardiac muscle contractility and totally the cardiac output. So the digitalis, it inhibits the sarcoplasmic calcium ATPase, then enzyme and responsible for the calcium intake by the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So ultimately it reduces the reuptake of calcium by the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and more calcium will be there, so that the force of the contraction is increased to a greater extent. So this is the structure of the digoxin, which is a glycoside. So this is the structure, and it occurs as a bitter tasting clear white crystalline solid, and derived from the leaves of Digitalis lanata, and insoluble in water, and this is slightly soluble in the alcohol. Then coming to the pharmacological effect on the heart, force of the contraction is greatly increased, and positive inotrophic action will take place, and complete ventricular emptying will happen with improved cardiac output and reduced diastolic pressure and reduction in the size of the dilated heart. Especially this drug is very useful in the CHF. What is CHF? That's the congestive heart failure. So by this congestive heart failure, especially whenever there is an enlarged heart, the cardiac glycosides are going to affect very properly, and complete ventricular emptying occurs, improved cardiac output occurs, reduced diastolic pressure will be there, and reduction in the size of the dilated heart. So the positive inotropic action means the force of the contraction is the like this, the instant of the contraction. So usually what happens simultaneously, there is inward movement of the sodium and a slow release of the inward movement of the calcium, whereas in the initial phase the potassium goes out and the intracellular calcium concentration will be increased, whereas because of the increased calcium contractions, then there is actin and myosin filaments, they start functioning, and there is a contraction of the heart, and the drugs that reduce the sodium influx or calcium influx will have the negative inotrophic action. So the digoxin is having a negative effect on the ATP in the sodium potassium exchange pump. So this is the place where it is going to act. So the whenever there is a hypokalemia, increase in the heart rate, because there is a exchange mechanism pump which is blocked by the digoxin. Then duration of systole will be shortened by administration of the cardiac glycosides, and the diastole is prolonged, means the blood which is flowing inside the heart will be pumped out very fast. Especially in case of congestive heart failure, digoxin reduces the peripheral vascular resistance. What's a peripheral vascular resistance means the capillary beds, especially in the entire body, will be spread like a wired mesh. So if there is a opposition action while flowing the blood, that is called as the peripheral resistance. And in normal heart, compensatory mechanisms counteracted with the inotrophic effect of the digoxin. So the heart rate, what happens after administration of the digoxin, there is a slow down of the heart rate by direct and indirect effects. What is a direct effect? It acts on the AV node, increased refractory period, and decreases in the conductivity. That's called as the negative chronotropic action. Whereas at high concentration, there is totally AV block will be seen in a very high dose, or what you call as the toxicity of the digoxin. What's an indirect effect? Increase in vagal tone, followed by the baroreceptor sensitization or the stimulation of the vagal center, especially in the brain. Whereas the excitability at low doses enhances the myocardial excitability by shifting resting membrane potential towards isoelectric. So the firing occurs very fast. At high doses, the decreases excitability by making resting membrane potential less negative, and that means towards positive. And rate of zero phase depolarization will be drastically, it is reduced. And the duration of the systole is shortened and the diastole is totally, it is prolonged, especially in case of the congestive heart failure. So what's a congestive heart failure means? Well, suppose the animal is having traumatic reticulopericarditis, then it will end up in the CHF because the blood which is pushed out of the body, especially the dependent parts like the neck part, etc., it will not come back properly. So that's called as the congestive heart failure. And in normal rest of the heart, compensatory mechanisms encountered the inotropic effect of the digoxin. Whereas the heart rate, what happens, it especially digitalis and other glycosides are going to this especially heart rate is lowered and indirect effects. Whereas the direct effect is the drug act on the AV node, increased refractory period and the decrease in conductivity. That's also called as the negative chronotropy. So at high concentration, it causes the AV block. So whenever there is a toxicity of this particular drug, when the animals are grazing by in the pasture land, then what happens is the heart rate slows, they acts on the AV node, increases the refractory period and decreases the conductivity, and high concentration, it causes the AV block. So the indirect ability, then automaticity. What is automaticity? Means the self functioning of the heart. So this reduces SA and AV node automatically by increasing the slope of the phase 4. So that is the repolarization phase. So especially in case of Purkinje fibers, slope of phase 4 is totally increased, then increasing ectopic autonomicity. So these are the actions, and apart from this one, high dose cause the coupled of the beating, it's a cardiac abnormality, and effective refractory period will the refractory period means the heart is quiescent in certain times, maybe a fraction of some milliseconds. And the vagus dependent action shortens the resting membrane potential of the atrial fibers. That's why there is a effective refractory period. However, the resting membrane potential of the AV conduction system will be prolonged and shortens the resting membrane potential of the ventricles, contributing to re-entrant arrhythmia. So in Purkinje fibers, resting membrane potential is shortened, decrease in the duration of the action potential. Duration of the action potential. So the electrocardiogram pattern, the T wave becomes smaller, P, Q, R, S and T, or it becomes inverted, or sometimes it may disappear also. So the depression of ST segment below the isoelectric line, and there will be PR interval, it is prolonged. So this is the pattern of the ECG after administration of the digoxin. So here, as earlier said, QT interval is shortened, QT interval is shorter, whereas the increased cardiac contractility causes the increased in MVO2, that's the myocardial oxygen consumption, which is influenced by inotropic state of the heart and well tension and heart rate. So the increased cardiac contractility causes the increased MVO2, that's the myocardial oxygen consumption. So however, all the digitalis therapy induced oxygen demand and overall effectivity is the improvement of the ventricular performance or failing heart without causing in the energy demand. So it doesn't require any ATP or any type of the energy. Without any other thing, it's going to act. Second one is the extracardiac effect of the glycosides are the blood pressure. There is no prominent effect on the total blood pressure, whereas the systolic pressure may increase, systolic contractile pressure may increase, and the diastolic pressure fall in CHF patients, especially if you administer the digoxin. Whereas the blood vessels, there will be mild direct vasoconstrictor effect on arteriolar and venous smooth muscles. So this will help to increase the blood pressure. Especially in case of congestive heart failure, net decrease in the peripheral resistance occurs. Especially in case of the normal individuals, the congestive heart failure patients, venous stone will be improved. Whereas the action of this drug on the kidney and the diuresis is, so there is sodium and water retention, especially in the kidney. That's the disadvantage. On the digitalization, increased urinary output and relief from the edema occurs. And the effect on the central nervous system, especially very high doses, cause nausea and vomiting. This is because the activation of the CTZ or the chemoreceptor trigger zone. And still in case of the higher concentration, hyperapnea, central sympathetic stimulation, disorientation, and there is visual disturbance or visual abnormalities. So coming to the kinetics, digoxin is mainly absorbed from the small intestine after the oral administration. And the presence of the food delays the absorption usually. Then the peak serum plasma level reaches the 45 to 60 minutes after the oral elixir or syrup, and 90 minutes after oral tablet. So the distributed throughout the body, the drug, if you administer, then it will be distributed throughout the body. Highest concentration in kidney, then the next organ is heart, and apart from the heart, stomach, intestine and liver, all these organs will have highest concentration of administered digoxin. Whereas the lowest concentration, especially in brain and the plasma, and the IV administration effect within very short time, that's the 5 to 30 minutes and maximum 2 hours, that should act. Then the oral admission, the drug will be effective in 1 to 2 hours of administration. So excreted mainly as unchanged drug as and when through the kidney. The plasma half-life of these drugs, especially in dogs, this drug is used very commonly in dogs and very cheap also among the cardiac drugs. Then the dogs, 24 to 55 hours is the half-life, whereas the cats it is 32 hours, whereas in case of cattle, it is 7 hours. So in different type of the animals, different half-life will be seen, because the dogs and cats are the monogastric animals, whereas the cattle is a polygastric drug, the agent, because it is containing rumen, reticulum, omasum and abomasum. Whereas the dogs, the absorption may be fast and action is also prolonged. And the side effect of the drug is, it is having very narrow margin of safety, means the safety index is less, and there occurs the another terminology, that is the digoxin toxicosis or cardiac glycoside toxicosis. It causes the cardiac arrhythmias, then there is a heart block, and by Germany paroxysmal tachycardia may also happen. Whereas the extra cardiac signs, there is diarrhea, anorexia, then the vomition may also be seen. So apart from this one, the other side effects are the milder toxicity, like the drowsiness and malaise. So if the serum concentration is less than 2.5 nanogram per milliliter, moderate toxicity is there. And then if the serum concentration is 2.5 to 6 nanogram, then the severe toxicity may occur, and when they exceed 6 nanogram, a high toxicity will be happening. And the treatment of the toxicity is discontinuation of the digitalis therapy and potassium depleting diuretics need to be administered, and use of specific antiarrhythmic drugs such as the phenytoin. It blocks the AV nodal effects and the local anesthetic, that's the lidocaine, which causes the ventricular arrhythmia. And propranolol and atropine, it causes the sinus bradycardia, especially the second and third degree AV block. So the digoxin immune fab in life threatening toxicity. So that's also one of the important thing. So contraindications, not to be used in case of ventricular fibrillation, heart block, and not due to the CHF, maybe the other reasons which causes the heart block. And in case of severe shock, it should not be administered by any route. Then renal and hepatic failure condition, so the less dose should be used, or else the toxicity may happen. And this drug need to be used with caution in severe pulmonary diseases, then the hypoxia or incomplete AV block, acute myocardial infarction, all these condition it is not to be used. Whereas in case of the animal, small doses with hypernatremia, hypokalemia, then hypercalcemia and reduced renal perfusion is the recommendation. Especially the IM injection causes lot of pain and muscle necrosis, so it is not advocated to administer it the IV. Whereas the oral administration is a very common phenomenon. And the drug interaction with the digoxin is the concurrent administration of quinidine, which this will increase the plasma concentration of the digoxin, quinidine. Then it's also a cardiac glycoside. And verapamil, that's the calcium channel blocker. Whereas the spironolactone, a diuretic, and the captopril also enhance the digoxin concentrations in the body. Whereas certain atacoids, cimetidine, metoclopramide, so these are the drug increase the amount of digoxin totally absorbed from the intestine. Then the administration of beta adrenoceptor agonists like propranolol, they increase likelihood of the arrhythmias. and the calcium synergizes with digoxin and precipitates the toxicity of this drug. And penicillamine may decrease the serum level of the digoxin, erythromycin, omeprazole, and tetracycline increase bioavailability of the digoxin. And you might have a surprise that many of the drugs are also acting on the heart and they cause certain side effects. Whereas the clinical uses are the cardiac glycosides used in case of treatment of congestive heart failure, atrial fibrillation or flutter, and the supraventricular tachycardia, and all these are coming to the normal level. And restore adequate circulation, especially in animals with congestive heart failure. So, especially in case of cattle, the CH of congestive heart failure occurs whenever there is a traumatic reticulopericarditis, especially in case of the cattle. And at that time, we can use the drug digoxin in the said dose. That is, the dose of this drug is 0.22 milligram to 2 milligram orally. That's the meter square, and times day, two times a day. So the 0.02 to 0.06 milligram per kg orally in two divided dose first day. Then it's called as the digitalization dose, whereas it need to be followed by 0.01 to 0.02 milligram of per kg orally in two divided doses, especially during the congestive heart failure. This is for the maintenance of the blood level, especially the glycosides. And cats and horses also have the similar doses, especially the oral dose is required. So the next drug is the digitoxin. The properties and other things are very similar to that of the digoxin, and the structure, there is a small difference between the digoxin and digitoxin. And obtained from the leaf of Digitalis purpurea, and both Digitalis lanata, and all the properties are very similar to that of the digoxin. And one of these property is it is highly bound to plasma, especially in case of dogs, and extensively metabolized in the liver and excreted in the urine. And dose of the digoxin is not gradually altered in case of the renal failure, so it is more sustainable or suitable in case of the patients with the renal insufficiency. So the half-life of this drug in case of dogs is 13 to 50 hours, as digoxin is more protein bound and less free to combine with myocardial target. Much larger dose is required for the action. And dose is very similar to that of the digoxin. Then ovaine is another drug. Then it is obtained from the Strophanthus gratus, and it is poorly absorbed from gut and also not plasma protein bound, and it is excreted by unchanged by the kidneys, and after IV rapid onset by 5 to 10 minutes and short duration of the action. Hence, it is a very suitable drug for the rapid digitalization. So dose is 0.01 milligram per kg, especially IV, because orally it is not absorbed. And here is a comparative table, especially the different drugs which are have especially cardiac glycosides. The first drug, that is the digoxin, they are combined with the digitoxin and ovaine. The lipid solubility is medium, whereas digitoxin is high, whereas the ovaine it is low. The oral absorption of the digoxin is good. The digitoxin is very good because of this property. It can be administered daily orally. Then the ovaine, it is very poor. Whereas the plasma protein binding, digoxin is 20 to 30%, Digitoxin is 70 to 90%, whereas it is very negligible, especially in case of the Obain. And the onset of action is just 1 to 2 hours, especially in case of digoxin, whereas it is still less, 0.5 to 2 hours, whereas it is still less in case of the Obain, 5 to 10 minutes. The metabolism, less than 20% of the drug is metabolized, whereas the digitoxin, greater than 80% of the drug gets metabolized. The Obain, it is very, very negligible. The half-life is 24 to 55 hours in case of the digoxin, and digitoxin, it is 13 to 50 hours. And the route of the administration of the digoxin is both oral and IV, whereas the digitoxin is only oral drug, whereas the Obain, it is only IV, because orally it is not absorbed. Hence, the route of the elimination, especially digoxin, is renal, whereas it is bile and renal in case of the digitoxin and Obain, it is renal. Whereas the plasma concentration is, therapeutic plasma concentration is 1 to 2.5 nanogram per ml, whereas the 15 nanogram per ml, especially in case of the animals, whereas the renal or the Obain, it is not available, whereas the toxic dose is more than 2.5 nanograms per ml of the blood and more than 26 nanogram per ml of the blood causes the toxicity. So that's about the cardiac glycosides in very fast, because the cardiac glycosides or the drugs acting on the heart are used only in case of the dogs and very rarely used in case of the cattle. Hence, please see the basic mechanisms of action of all these three drugs and also the toxicity aspect, a little bit about the dose and the ultimately the toxic property of this drug. So with this, we will complete the today's class.